Bingo. Second time. They're brilliant. They look brilliant.
I think that they are the scariest monsters in Doctor Who ever.
Just the way they move is doom, 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 doom.
I was hoping they'd come back.
There's such savageness in their face, but at the heart of it is a children's game. It's a perfect Doctor Who monster, you know? The Doctor is intrigued by everything and gives everything a chance. The Weeping Angels, it's hard to, because they are only, you know, they're pretty much on the road to evil.
To my great surprise, and it wasn't a plan at all, I'd come up with a fantastically successful Doctor Who monster, which, let me say, beat the Daleks in the polls twice, which I'm incredibly proud of. So, with my own Doctor Who monster that I've invented, I want to bring it back.
I just think the creation of the Weeping Angels are just so clever, because I just think they are so scary. And actually, it's really simple what he's done, but really, really effective because of that.
But it's just a statue.
It's a statue when you see it.
When you see them, at first, they're really beautiful and graceful, and there's something really, really eerie about that. And then when they get all fanged and feral, it's really shocking when you look at it. It does actually make your heart go poof.
You know, you could have had a robot that couldn't move unless you blinked. And that would have been good enough, but actually making it one of those things is just horrible.
But there's something quite basic, I think. There's something very frightening inherently in the idea that something can only, you know, only it comes to life when you don't look at it, you know.
I'm going to turn off this one too, just for a moment.
Are you sure about this?
No.
Oh my God, they've moved.
It's so clever, it's such a clever conceit, because actually, if you think about it, it's all based on Grandma's footsteps. You know that game?
When I think of the playground game, I'm not being cheap. I'm thinking that's creatively engaging your audience in a way that means they can play at it and they can think of a new bit in that game, a new exciting bit. What if this happened and what if that happened? And what they're doing there is their heads are setting alight and they're making up stories. And that is exciting. And Doctor Who does it better than anything else ever.
My favourite Stephen Moffat episode of Doctor Who is Blink.
Don't blink. Blink and you're dead.
And it's actually my mum's favourite episode as well.
I don't think I ever get to talk to anybody now without them bringing up Blink.
I mean, I loved Blink. Everyone loves Blink.
I sat in the dub and thought, this is a good episode. I'm really pleased with it. I'm really proud of it. But I didn't think that would be the highlight of my career. And I'll have wibbly wobbly
timey wimey stuff
on my gravestone. Hooray for that as a quote, eh?
It's interesting with the Weeping Angels, because in Blink you'd think, oh, maybe that's all we'll ever know about them, that they're quite mysterious, that we shouldn't know anything more about them. We don't want them to become commonplace, things that you might see every now and again.
The angels you see in Blink are the same angels. I mean, they're stronger in here, and there's a different breed of angels. You know, there is more variety of them. But we see the process of their evolution.
What I think Stephen's done really cleverly in this two-parter is to tell us more about them and yet still leave more mystery uncovered. That actually sometimes if you peel away a layer of mystery, you're just uncovering another layer of mystery. So exactly who are they? You know, who created them? Did they create themselves? Were they people once? They seem to have some kind of plan.
Doctor.
Ah, don't you see all that radiation spilling out the drive burn? The crash of the Byzantium wasn't an accident. It was a rescue mission for the angels. We're in the middle of an army, and it's waking up.
The design of those angels is absolutely stunning. Nobody expected them to be quite as scary as that. They're just scary when they stand outside having a fag. They're terrifying. And it's just some nice girls, really.
The deformed angel, which is basically a very crumbled statue, and it's hardly even recognisable as an angel. It's just more of a disfigured form. And you can just about make out its features, maybe the eyes, the nose, but only just. Then you've got the semi-formed, which is halfway mark, basically, between the deformed and the fully formed angels. They're still like slightly reddish in the rock as deformed angels, but they've got more features, and you can make out the skirt, the sort of hair, the features a lot more now. And then you've got the fully formed ones, which is a fully formed statue without any breaks or cracks or a change of colour. So we were casting angels who were a particular size and height. And then what we do, we'd get them in for a fitting.
Quite comfortable because it's molded to my face shape. It's surprisingly easy to keep still in it. As soon as you kind of put it on, you kind of almost freeze into kind of positions anyway, because it's quite a restricted kind of costume. You don't tend to want to move too much, so you sort of just end up standing still without even really realizing that you're standing still.
Oh, perfect.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Get her out.
They're in the costume for around about probably 10 hours. Not the face. We tend to leave that until they're actually required on set. But we dress up right up to the neck here. And they're quite comfortable in that outfit.
I played one of the clockwork women. This costume's quite a bit heavier and quite a bit more restrictive than that one. I had a mask on in the other one, which wasn't glued to my face. Whereas all the stuff for this costume is generally glued down and I'm painted on and everything takes a bit longer.
These poor girls that have to go through sort of 4 or 5 hours of prosthetics and makeup, and they're all dancers, and they have to stay so still. And then it was cold, it was late at night, we were doing night shoots, and then they've got steam sort of coming out of their mouth at the same time, so they've got to go and action, but they can't breathe because the steam would come out, then we'd know that it's a human being underneath in a costume.
And action rehearsal.
The angels are scared and running. Right now, they're not that interested in you. They'll assume you can't see them and their instincts will kick in. All you gotta do, walk like you can see.
Well, the forest was a logistical nightmare, really, because they're not just a makeup that you can stick on and colour up and then they can walk around quite freely. There are so many sections to them. As I said, like they have the great big rigid latex skirts. And then you've got the wings. We don't have a nicely lit makeup bus, so we can then stick the pieces on them. We have to then take them down and set, and outdoor locations in England on a summer's night is probably, as you know, very wet and damp. And so with torchlight, under an umbrella, we're there sticking on the faces on them.
It feels very weird. Really strange. This part, I feel like I'm wearing a nappy the whole time. It's really quite hard to walk in. You're walking around like a duck. Today, in particular, was really quite difficult to wear because it was quite hot. And at times, I just wanted to rip it off me. But you get through it. It's like a sauna on your body, really.
The deformed angels take probably just under 2 hours because it's quite a free-fitting costume. And the girls can almost dress themselves to a point, but then obviously you need someone to come in and just tie up and tidy up pieces and just make sure it's all fitted nicely, and then gluing.
It's glued to your body, the parts where it can be crinkled, but the rest of it is all just costume, really. And then the head goes on right at the last minute because it is a bit horrible to wear, so they wait until the very last minute and then they put it on.
They can see out of the masks. There's a small little hole through the eyes. But what happens is once they're in shot, we have these two little discs that we then put in. to the eye sockets, and so that they are then totally blind, they can't see a thing.
I showed a picture to my mum of my costume, and I thought she was going to say, like, oh, wow, that's really great, it looks fantastic, and she sort of turned around and said, oh, is that your real stomach? And I was like, what are you kidding? This is my, you know, is my skin really like this? No, it's not. It's pure foam. It's quite baggy on me as well, actually.
It's an awful lot of work. It's not difficult, but there's just so many procedures that you have to go through to get the finished article.